that brings us to lovely Mr. Paul Revere. And I'm showing you an English creamware teapot. This is what's great about the British potters. They were perfectly happy to make money off of the protest against the British colonial government. So they cranked out No Stamp Act teapots in Staffordshire and shipped them over so we could buy them. So at the time that Copley paints Revere, he's already part of the Sons of Liberty. So I would suggest to you that maybe he's not thinking so much about engraving and about silversmithing as he is about tea, because this is after the Stamp Act and the Townsend Acts. So we're already in the midst of the consumer boycotts. And it's T.H. Breen, historian T.H. Breen, who postulates this idea that diverse groups of Americans, right, from different regions, from different religions and ethnicities, in fact, were able to create a common community based on their use of certain consumer goods and invent this new form of political protest, the consumer boycott. And right here in Salem, the heads of families agreed to abstain from drinking tea. Everybody knows about the non-importation agreements. As I said, the Sons of Liberty commissioned a punch bowl. And this is probably the most iconic piece of American silver. And it is to memorialize the 92 members of the House of Representatives who refused to rescind the letter protesting the imperial policy. And it's really the first public act against the British crown, the first rebellion, and of course by Paul Revere. And the 15 members who commissioned it are around the top. And there's a better view of the engraving. And like much silver, this thing has got engraving all over it. So it was engraved again in the 1830s on the bottom. So every time it sort of changed hands or someone had possession of it, they would add another inscription onto it. But this is the original inscription. You see the Phrygian hat. This was the ancient symbol of manumission, you know, when you freed slaves in the ancient world. And then got a better picture on the other side, Wilkes and Liberty, number 45. John Wilkes wrote in the North Britain, his publication, you know, defending the rights of Englishmen, was hugely popular here, and number 45 was the issue of, you know, the number of one of his most famous publications. So you have Bill of Rights, the Magna Carta, and the Phrygian hat. Again, and this is just a great detail, so Liberty. And you really get a sense of the engraving in the surface. And interestingly, this whole numerology, you see this again and again, the numerology of number 45 the glorious 92. So the bowl itself is 45 ounces of silver. Wait, 45, yeah, 45 ounces of silver. It holds 45 gills of rum, right? And you'll read things in the newspaper like the ladies of Charlestown delivered, 45 skeins of homespun wool to the ministers in Boston. So this kind of symbolic numerology comes over and over. All right, so I just want to talk a little bit about the three. Because to me, as a material culture historian, it's extremely thrilling that there's actually these silver tea services that were included in the Picturing America series. So Paul Revere's father was a French Huguenot. The Huguenots were persecuted in France. Many of them went to England and to Holland and eventually here. And that's the case with Apollos Rivois, who was Paul Revere's father. And he came here and he apprenticed to one of our Boston silversmiths. I want to get it right. John Coney, whose Monteith I showed you. And in fact, when Coney dies, he dies before Paul Revere Sr. completes his apprenticeship, and he has to buy out the rest of his apprenticeship. But anyway, this is a very early cut by him, a sort of charming apprentice effort, I think. He's not a very good silversmith yet. So this is Paul Revere's dad. Paul Revere himself has a very, very long career. He trains under his father, and his career is really divided into two sections. Earlier, before the Revolution, when he's working in the predominantly the Rococo style, and then the neoclassical style that he adopts after the Revolution. So I'm just showing you a few examples of his work from the 1760s. A beautiful salver, a little footed tray, not that little, for the Gardner Chandler family. And here's the coat of arms from their book plate. And this is another book plate that Revere did. You see how it's reversed, right? So this is, he did this engraving, and then you would print them out so you would have your, to mark your books. So again, the related craft. Here's two other examples, again, in the what was the prevailing Rococo, this very curved, linear style with these big cartouches. This was for the Derby family here in Salem, a pair of sauce boats. Now, interestingly, by the time Revere was already a very prosperous, successful artisan, right? Silversmiths, they handled money, so they're already at that sort of elite level of craftsmanship, trusted craftsmen. After the Revolution, Revere really expands out. He becomes the first president of the Massachusetts Charitable Mechanics Association. He starts a cannon works and brass foundry. He starts a huge in Canton, Mass, a big mill for rolling copper, which is what they sheathe ships with. Robert Fulton's steamboats were sheathed with copper from Revere's mills. So he really becomes an early industrialist. So, and at the, later in his life, this portrait in 1813 by Gilbert Stuart, he's very much presenting himself no longer as the artisan in shirt sleeves. He's a successful businessman and a gentleman, and that's how he sees himself. So this is the group of silver that's included in the Picturing America series. And this is already a time. Paul is not in there silversmithing away. He's got a bunch of people working for him, and he's using new industrial methods to produce silver. So instead of silver that's being beaten up by hand, this kind of silver is rolled out in sheets mechanically. And it is then put around a mold and it's soldered and seamed. You can crank this stuff out much faster. In fact, the entire product of his shop by this time is becoming standardized. You will note, if you look carefully, this is in fact an assembled set. It's not really a set, but it was easy to assemble because so much of what Revere is doing is very, very similar. So neoclassical, vase mania, they loved vases, Roman helmets, the flutes, of course, recall the profiles of columns. So that's the vocabulary that he's working in with these lovely little draped urns. And also note, no coats of arms in the New Republic, right? Because we are an egalitarian society. So now you use monograms. Monograms were seen as much more sort of Republican than coats of arms. So that's the new style.